Hello and welcome to another Roblox tutorial. In this video, I will be going over the new Rate Workspace Raycast function along with Raycast Params and Raycast Result, which Roblox has implemented recently. And if you don't know already, they deprecated the old system, which was like Workspace Find Part on Ray and like whatever. Like it doesn't even show up anymore. So they still kept the Ray class, but you really don't need to use it anymore. But I hope you guys enjoy this video. Make sure to like and subscribe if you do. I absolutely love these functions and the Raycast Params and Results. They're so useful, so convenient, and so simple. So this has been requested a lot recently, and I hope you enjoy. But without further ado, let's get into the video. So I have right in front of me a part, and if you're wondering why the front is black, that's just to show me what the front face is, because they got rid of the surface, like, property drop-down, so now I can't really tell. I have to use, like, a surface GUI to do that. But we're going to use this part to use the new Raycast function. And so now I'm going to go into my part and create a script, and we're just going to make a basic Raycast. And so the function that we're using is obviously workspace.raycast. So this is what it looks like, workspace colon raycast. It's a lot simpler than find part on Ray, or like find part on Ray with whitelist or blacklist, whatever. So this function and everything with the new Ray system in Roblox does not use the Ray property type. It doesn't need to use it. You can use it if you really want to, but it just adds, it takes away a layer of complexity in regards to this function. So it takes in three parameters: the origin, the direction, and an optional parameter, which is the raycast params. There we go. So obviously I haven't defined any of these, so they're all red. But, and also it returns a raycast result. So there we go. So this is basically the signature of our function. So let's not worry about the raycast params for now. It's really powerful, but let's just talk about the most useful things, which are the origin, direction, and result, because these are the things you'll be using most of the time. So I'm going to define the origin, which will be part.position, and I'm going to define the direction, which is the part.cframe.lookVector. Times, let's say, 10 studs. So this works like any other normal raycast. And if you really want to, or like you're using a user input service function, you could define your ray, which would be ray.new origin direction, and then when you're putting it into the raycast function, you could do ray.origin and ray.direction. There you go. So you could also do that. I wouldn't recommend it because it adds an extra line of code. You have to instantiate a new object. That's just not as good and simple as just saying origin and direction. So let me just get rid of that. So now if I were to run this, you can see nothing happens, obviously, because we have no code that does anything. But now let's talk about the raycast result, which is the thing that gets returned when you perform a successful raycast. And since it only gets returned when you perform a successful raycast, you have to check if it exists. Because if you cast into the sky and there's like nothing there, then it won't do anything. So we have to check if raycast result, then. And now let's list some of the properties. So raycast result dot position is just the position in which the ray collides. And then raycast result dot instance is the part or terrain in which it collides with. And these are probably the two most important. But then some really useful ones is raycast result dot normal. And so the normal is basically a vector 3 that just describes like the angle at which your part that the instance is situated. So It's kind of hard to explain. I think I explained it in better detail in my light reflection simulation videos, so you can check those out if you want a better description. And lastly, we have raycast result dot material, and this just gives you the material of the part slash terrain where it happens. So I have right here a little part that I set up earlier. He didn't see me set it up because it was like last clip. So here we have our part. Let's just move it a little closer. And if we were to run this, you can see the position is 11, the instance is the part. We have the normal since it's rotated a little bit, and it's brick material. That's exactly what we want. Let me just increase this to 100 so we can test this a little better. So this is everything you need to know about the raycast result. So now let's go into raycast params. And so the params is the third parameter, optional parameter that you can send to Workspace Raycast. So let's define a raycast params object here. So local raycast params equals capital raycast params, if I can spell it right, dot new. And so you can sort of compare this data type to like a tween info, but unlike a tween info, you can't like instantiate the object with any constructor parameters. So like anything I type in here, it won't do anything because there's no, it only has one constructor. But also unlike a tween info, you can edit the properties after you make it, which is really good because you can dynamically change what your array is like doing. So let's start with raycast params. So look, so this is our raycast params. There's a few properties that you can change. First one we're going to talk about is filter descendants instances. So this is just like a list of parts, of models, of folders that the array will ignore. So let's set this up real quick. I'm just going to reset the orientation real quick because it's bothering me. There we go. Let's drag this back here. Let's duplicate it. It's going to be our red part. We're going to make it a red and foreboding. So we're going to name this part red. And we can duplicate it and make a blue part, let's say. So let's give it nice blue. So if we go into here, we can set the filter descendants instances to workspace.red, comma, workspace.blue. And so it'll ignore these. But in order to set it to ignore them, you have to set raycast params dot filter type. So you can either set it to enum dot raycast filter type dot blacklist or whitelist. So if you set it to blacklist, it will ignore the parts in the filter descendants instances. If you set it to whitelist, it'll only hit the parts in those things. So let's just set it to blacklist, and then let's make sure to pass our raycast params object into the function. So if we were to run this, you can see it still hits our green part back here. It skips over red and blue. But if we were to set it to whitelist, it'll obviously hit the red part. But then if we were to move the red and the blue out of the way, so it should be hitting the green, it doesn't do anything because it's whitelisted to that, which is exactly what you want to happen. And so along with the filtering, there's another property which I rarely use, but you can use it if you want, and it's ignore water. It's a boolean, true or false, that just says if it should ignore water when it recasts. That's pretty self-explanatory. But then you have another property, which this is really, really cool. And this is actually the reason that this raycast caused the old raycasting system to be deprecated. That's because raycastParams.collisionGroup. So this allows you to define a collision group in which your rays can be casted. So let's just go create some collision groups real quick. I'm going to go to model and then collision groups. I already had it open. I put it like I docked it down here. And so you see, I already have a collision group set up. We can just get rid of that. So now we have our default collision group. This is the default group where all parts can collide. But let's add another group, and let's add a red collision group. And let's also add a blue collision group. We'll keep our green one on default. So you have all these check marks, whatever. I'm not going to explain all this. That's a tutorial for another day. But I can just make red and blue not collide with default, and then make red not collide with blue. So all of these parts will not collide with one another, which is pretty useful in certain situations. But what makes it even more useful is the fact that rays can interpret this. So let's set our raycast params.collision group to firstly default. So this is just the default group, and if we were to run this, it would obviously ignore it. That's because we said it earlier. Let's just actually comment these out so it doesn't affect our results, the filter type and whatever. So if we run this, you can see it hits red because we haven't set their collision groups specifically yet. So let's do that real quick. That almost threw off that right there. But so let's set our red part to the red collision group right there, and our blue part to the blue collision group, and our green part will be default. So let's run this again. Let me go to the output. It hits our part because it skips both of these because they're part of a different collision group, which is exactly what you want. And with that, I can also set another collision group like blue. So if we were to run this here, it'll hit the blue one. And what's really cool about this, or it could be cool, it could just be a hassle, is if let's say our red part can collide with blue, it'll actually hit the red part since they can collide, which is an interesting feature. I wish they would allow you to toggle whether you want that or not, but it still is pretty interesting, could be useful if you're in that sort of situation. And by the way, the default collision group for this property is obviously default. But yeah, that's about it for this property. So that's about it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed. Sorry for my voice. I'm like sort of losing it right now since it's like fall just started and whatever. So I hope you could understand me. But I hope you guys enjoyed because everyone's been requesting a new Raycast video, and here is. And this new Raycast system, I absolutely love it because it's very simple on the surface, but you can make it very specialized the more you go. And you can also implement this with a user input service to make your own custom mouse, which is pretty cool. I'll probably make a video of that in the future. But make sure to like and subscribe if you enjoyed, and I hope you have a nice day, and goodbye.